Hi. Thank you all for coming. I knew the word Armageddon would get at least some of you. I use it all the time, but I won't disappoint you. We will talk a little bit about Armageddon, but we'll actually leave it alone for a big chunk of the lecture and come back to it at the very end. But first, let's talk about, for just a moment, this passage from the book of Revelation that this word comes from. It's pretty grim, but interesting. The sixth angel poured his bowl on the great river Euphrates, and its water was dried up in order to prepare the way for the kings from the east. And I saw three foul spirits like frogs coming from the mouth of the dragon, from the mouth of the beast, and from the mouth of the false prophet. These are demonic spirits performing signs who go abroad to the kings of the whole world to assemble them for battle on the great day of God the Almighty. And they assembled them at the place that in Hebrew is called Harmageddon. And Harmageddon, of course, being a corruption of the Hebrew Har Megiddo, the hill of Megiddo. And it's really the hill of Megiddo that we'll start with today, which is, of course, in the Jezreel Valley in Israel. And hopefully you know more or less where Israel is here in the eastern Mediterranean. We're talking about the Jezreel Valley, which is in the north, just south of Haifa. And here it is here. It's a particularly important place geographically, and this is proven time and again from the entire history of the world, because it is a major hub of roads, and we'll have opportunity to see this a couple of times in this lecture. As you can see, it's a large inland valley, but it's connected by passes back to the coast in a number of places, to the northern coast and up to Phoenicia, and through several passes eastward into the Jordan River Valley, and of course southward into Samaria. So anyone traversing greater Israel or the entire Levant from north to south usually has to pass through here. And that explains why Megiddo, as well as other places in the valley, became such important centers across time and space. So zooming in on Megiddo, Megiddo is probably a place that you've heard before. It's very famous for its tell, which is at the northern upper side of the image here. Tell Megiddo is, of course, a major Bronze and Iron Age center, which we won't be talking about today. Instead, we'll be talking about some of the other things that are going on in the place that Megiddo occupied, particularly in the Roman period. And if you look at Greek and Latin sources from these particular periods, we hear reference of three major settlements. One, a Jewish village of Caparcotani, also known as Caparcotani in the Latin. We hear of a Roman legionary base, which is sometimes referred to as legio from Latin legion. And we also hear about a Byzantine polis, a city by the name of Maximianopolis. And for the most part, for a greater part of the last century, the location of these three places within this broader landscape has been relatively unknown. We'll be talking about some of the clues that help us piece that together today. I suppose the first clue is worth mentioning right now, since I put it on the slide anyway, and that is that there was an early Islamic village located in this area, known as Lejeun, of course, from Legio, and that village continued all the way on into the modern times throughout the Ottoman period, right up until the late 19th century. So we know very well where Lejeun is, and we know that its name is taken from the Roman settlement there, which kind of helps us in the end to identify the location of our legionary base. Take a look at Roman roads, which I think will help you understand the centrality of the Jezreel Valley. All in yellow and red, and this side over here are the major Roman roads. And if you look carefully and try to plot them out, you see that they come to centralized points in two places here, one in Jerusalem and the other here in the Megiddo-Legio area in the Jezreel Valley. We can also see this from the famous Peutinger map, which is a 5th century Roman map, Byzantine map, which is actually derived from earlier sources and probably represents, at least in this part of the world, what the 1st and 2nd centuries looked like. And here you can see the Mediterranean coast, the city of Caesarea, Caparcotani, and Scythopolis Beit Shan here, which represented in the real world is one of the most important east-west roads in Roman Levant, connecting the major capital port at Caesarea with the inland areas and ultimately the Decapolis cities in the Jordan Valley. So once again, zooming into our area, and you get a sense of how the road passes through this important location. Now, this road has changed a lot over the 7,000 plus years of human habitation in the area. You know, maybe they go up this hill one millennium and down this hill in another millennium. But ultimately, I mean, this was more or less the major pass leading from the coast to the inland routes through most of human history. And as I've said before, with the Jezreel Valley as a hub, once you get into it, you can kind of leave it and get to anywhere else, up to the Phoenician coast, into the Jordan Valley, onto Damascus, Mesopotamia, and so on. And this wasn't, of course, lost on the Romans. Brief historical overview of the Legio Megiddo area. Of course, as I said, the tell on the north side here was a major Bronze and Iron Age, survived into the Hellenistic periods, possibly destroyed by Alexander, after which settlement left the tell and concentrated on the areas around it, which is what we'll be talking about in a moment. The Jezreel Valley as a whole, during the Herodian period in the late first century BC, was an important agricultural center, but not a major urban center. Most of the valley was probably owned and operated and administered by Herod and his wife, Bernice, who had an administrative center at Beit Shearim. Many of you probably know this place is an important second and third century Jewish village. It was instrumental in the development and ultimately the writing down of the Mishnah. The city Geba Hippion was probably the only other important city during the Herodian period, just north of Megiddo. We won't talk about that today, but I will tell you we are planning excavations here probably in the next couple of years. The period that interests us most for this particular lecture is the early and middle Roman periods, the first three or four centuries AD. And I think it's worth just reviewing very briefly some of the major historical events of this period because they have a dramatic impact on why we see what we see at the Megiddo area, in the Megiddo area. First of all, many of these things you will all be familiar with. The famous First Revolt of 67 to 70 AD, which resulted in the destruction of Jerusalem and ultimately the settlement of the Roman 10th Legion in the area. This is the first Roman legionary base that is established in the southern Levant and becomes, of course, very famous in Jewish history and Jewish mythology going forward. One of the results of that occupation of Jerusalem was the beginning of a new settlement process in the Galilee, in which Jewish villages, though have already started settling in the Hellenistic period, surge in the Galilee area. And that is probably why we start to see the hub of Roman roads connected in this area, especially in this particular period. The less known Quito's War, the Diaspora Revolt of 115 to 117, is an important outbreak. A Jewish and incipient Christian revolt occurring throughout the empire. But right at the end of that, we hear from historical sources that the Roman 2nd Legion, Triana, was sent to the Levant, the southern Levant, and stationed there. Exactly where is not clear, though we now believe that it was in the Megiddo area for a variety of reasons. By 120, we hear of the 6th Ferrata Legion, and this is the legion that interests us most for this particular lecture, and the legion which I think will have the most impact on the concept of Armageddon by the time we get to the end of the talk. So they're stationed there already in 120, and then, of course, the famous Bar Kokhba Revolt from 132 to 136, after which Jerusalem is refounded as Aelia Capitolina, a very pagan city, and we see the last remnants of Jews from Judah who are going to make the big move to the north taking place. And just an epilogue to this historical overview, we know that a city of Maximianopolis was established in the Constantinian period, very early on, right around 300 or shortly thereafter. And going forward back to in full circle, by 700 CE, the village of Lejeune is established next to Maximianopolis. So it's within that historical framework, especially the era of the Jewish revolts, that will begin our story. Megiddo is one of the most excavated tells in all of Israel, and we know a lot about it, and we can have a lot of other lectures about that if you want, but we're going to kind of skip over that and try to focus on the areas around it. Some of the first excavations and surveys took place in 1902 to 1905 by Gottlieb Schumacher on behalf of the German Society of Oriental Research. Don't let his name fool you. He was American. He was from Ohio. He's a first-generation German immigrant. So he got to keep the cool name before they started calling him Mark or whatever. His work is particularly important. He did work on Tel Megiddo, and he did kind of butcher it, and we usually don't sing his praises when we're talking about his giant gash through the center of the Tel, but we do want to sing his praises for his larger survey of the area, which not only put Megiddo on the map, literally, but put Greater Megiddo on the map. And that is, if we think about Greater Megiddo as everything that's happening outside of the Tel, and you look at his survey map over here, all of this in red are things that he marked as having seen during his survey of the area. Now, most of this stuff is completely gone. He reports already in 1903 that villagers from the developing city of Umm al-Fahim, not far away, were coming by the cartload and carrying off massive stones, including columns and inscribed blocks from the entire area south of here and over here. If you visit this area today, you would have to be a really exceptional, even archaeologist, to know that anything was here before modern times. So he stands as one of the only records of a lot of the material found outside of Tel Megiddo itself. And of course, over the last 100 years, Tel Megiddo has been such an important Iron Age place for excavation that archaeologists and historians, and tourists for that matter, have tended not to look outside of the Tel at the more complex settlement history in the region. A few of the things I want to point out, because we're ultimately leading up to trying to identify the Roman legionary base in the region, and we'll come to that in just a moment. But some of the things that Schumacher already saw outside of the Tel, first of all, there's a spring on the north side, which exists today, called Ain al-Kubi, a number of ruins nearby. But he identified a series or fragments of aqueducts, which led from the spring southward. He also identified, not far away, just to the south, a theater, which is actually an amphitheater. It's never been excavated, but it's clearly of Roman origin. Now, that's looking at the top. Looking at the southern portion of his survey map, he identified, again, more continuation of aqueducts in a variety of places, including over here, a number of aqueducts which were headed in this direction as well. He also, in among all of these ruins here, identified quite a few Roman and Byzantine remains, including columns in situ on what was probably the main decumanus, the main road of the Byzantine city, still in place over here. I think I have a picture of that coming up. Ah, down here. It's not a very good picture, but you see that they have been buried almost all the way to the top, but they are still more or less in place. And this picture also shows you a number of items found in the area, particularly in the village of Lejeune, which was still occupied in his day on the south side. Some of the houses still standing, having taken columns and other blocks and reused them. Here, a Byzantine cross, probably from Maximianopolis. One of the big questions that my team had, which is the one I want to focus on today, is the location of the legionary base of what we now know as the 2nd and 3rd century. You know, the historical sources that I referred to before give us an indication that it's somewhere in the vicinity of Megiddo, and of course the logic of the roads in the period also suggests that if there's a major legionary base, it's going to be somewhere on these major roads. But exactly where was not clear, and I realize only later that in this image I already tell you where it is, but I mean the next series of slides to kind of be a mystery and to help you figure out that location, so just go with me. So, of course, the first datum point that we really have is the village of Lejeune, which has been around since the 7th century, the 8th century, and continued as especially strong during the Ottoman period. There was a major caravanserai there, and in fact, if you look closely, that dot is exactly on a small square that is the Ottoman Han, the caravanserai. As I said, most of the work for the last century has focused on Tel Megiddo, and so we're going to skip over these very famous excavations which have taken place there, and instead talk for just a moment about various salvage excavations and people wandering around and finding various items in this vicinity that may help us figure out where the legionary base is located. This one is particularly famous. Has anybody been to the Rockefeller Museum in Jerusalem? This lion, which was found during the British Mandate period just on the edge of this field here, is now has a pipe connected to it and sits at the head of the fountain outside, so it's nice, I guess. But It's in a museum in any case. Also, a number of Roman cooking pots have been found all up and down this road, three or four of them over the last century, all with cremated remains, which is, of course, a Roman burial practice. On the south side of the area of interest is what is today known as the Megiddo Prison, but was originally built as a police station during the Mandate period. And the British, fortunately, did do some salvage excavations before construction there, though nobody remembered that until about a decade ago when my colleague Yotam Tepper started going through the archives to find out material from this place. And that's one thing I forgot to mention right at the beginning. You'll saw that in addition to my name, I had two other names here. And the things that I'm presenting today are really part of a collaborative project between myself, Yotam Tepper, who is now at the University of Haifa and formerly of the Israel Antiquities Authority, and my other colleague, Jonathan David of Gettysburg College. We're very much working together on this, so I want to make sure that they get credit. And Yotam is very central to this story because already in the 90s, during his master's work and later during his PhD work, he spent a lot of time in the Megiddo area trying to track down the location of this legionary base. Right, so we're back at the police station. Salvage excavations revealed a lot of architecture. Most of it was destroyed during the construction. We don't know a lot about it, but there were enough clues to indicate that this was, in fact, a Jewish village, including a stone door, which is a typical type of the second and third century for tombs. Here with a Hebrew Samaritan inscription mentioning the name of Ephraim Bar Shimon. Now, this Samaritan connection is actually very interesting and important because Kfar Odnai does show up in several rabbinic sources, none of them gloriously interesting from an historical point of view, but with enough reference to suggest that the Jewish village here was in fact Samaritan-oriented, as you can see here. We don't have to read all of them, but just a few examples here. There are references to particular rabbis who had visited the area already, probably in the first century, suggesting the village was established already then. The city is mentioned as one of the southern border towns of the Halakha, the Jewish religious law, which governed the Galilee. The famous Rabbi Gamliel judged a case in the area involving Samaritans related to witnesses of divorce documents. And then his son, a generation later, Shimon ben Gamliel, named the village as a very great place to find Samaritan vegetables, if that's what you're looking for. So there is clearly a Samaritan connection, and what that means historically is something that we'll be pursuing otherwise. So we can now draw on our map. In addition to Lejeune, we have a good idea of where Kfar Odnai is underneath the prison. We'll come back to this prison shortly. Yotam conducted a number of surveys in the area. I don't know why I do this to you, but this satellite image is now turned sideways, so Megiddo is here, and the prison is very carefully blocked out here by the Israelis, who don't want you to know where the prison is, but it's here, trust me. In his survey, he identified quite a bit of Roman material focused mainly on this hill here, which we know as El Manach. This is the name of the hill that the local villagers gave to it and which Schumacher reported to us. Some examples of pottery, a number of complete Roman water supply pipes, and fortunately, roof tiles stamped with the name of the Roman 6th Legion, which is very convenient for our mystery here. So back to the prison, Yotam, after years of survey in the area, became well known as the archaeologist with the best knowledge of the area. And so he was called upon when the prison was to be expanded and new salvage excavations were to take place. This took place in 2003 or 4, with some major news hitting in 2005 that some of you may or may not be familiar with. In general, what he was able to identify is, yes, indeed, this is most likely the village of Kfar Odnai. There is plenty of evidence for Jewish activity, in fact, Samaritan activity as well through other inscriptions. But also, there's evidence for Christians and pagans and civilians and Roman soldiers all interacting in this village here. Just a few artifacts for you, some Roman bread stamps with good Roman names on them, Jewish ritual vessels. Here, bronze figurines of Lares, the Roman pagan household deity, so on. Most famous in his excavations was this large hall with a mosaic in the center of it, which you see here. It's a very nice mosaic. It's in the middle of a larger complex, which is probably a large villa, and the hall sits in the back corner. And this has now become quite famous. especially because its inscriptions have some very important information for us. This one, not any less than the others, but I'll read it anyway. Gaionus, also called Peripherius, centurion, our brother, has made the pavement at his own expense as an act of liberality. Brutus has carried it out. So here we have a Roman soldier, a centurion, who has given over money to this fellow Brutus for the laying of this mosaic here. The second and the most important inscription here, the god-loving Ekeptus has offered the table, which we assume refers to this object here, to God, Jesus Christ, as a memorial. The building itself dates to the 3rd century sometime, and this represents the earliest archaeological data attesting to Jesus Christ. The other one is my favorite. Remember Pramila and Kyriaka and Dorotea? Oh yeah, and also Cresti. I feel like it was such a snub. Yeah, we'll put your name in the mosaic. What's important about this more than that is that we have women dedicating mosaics here, which is not necessarily rare. What's important is the broader context. We have a mosaic hall, which is partially paid for by a Roman centurion, which mentions the god, Jesus Christ, and also has a table as a central focus, and women are an important contributor to this establishment as well. And what emerges interpretively is probably something we understand from early New Testament studies as a domus ecclesiae, one of these early house churches before the Byzantine period, pre-Constantinian, before churches and the rigid hierarchy of early Christianity was put in place. And all of these features, including the role of women, the role of tables in the agape meal, which would in some ways evolve partially into the Eucharist ritual as well, makes this one of the important discoveries in the Megiddo area. And again, what's really interesting about it is not just the inscriptions, but also the archaeological finds from inside of the building. We see that there are Romans, in particular Roman soldiers, maybe even Roman pagans. Another of these Lares statuettes was found in the house as well. And there are Jewish finds as well from the building. So Kfar Odnai, you know, though most of you have probably never heard of it before, was probably one of the most interesting and diverse villages in the Galilee. Moving on to the location of the military base is a thorough study of the roads in the area, some of which can be seen archaeologically coming through the hills, and others which have been identified, as on this map here with these dots, by Roman milestones that have been found in place. And these milestones are very important and convenient for us because they refer to the number of miles to the most important town nearby, and they name the most important town, which happens to be on many of these inscriptions either Caparcotani or Legio, depending on which time that they are referenced. So we have enough of them to triangulate back to this general area here as one of the important centers for the Roman roads. Putting all of these things together, finds from over a century, historical documents, and of course, more academic surveys and excavation projects, what emerges is a centralized area which may be the location of the Roman legionary base. And this was more or less the background research which led my team to begin excavation work and survey work and then excavation work in this area as well. So if we're looking for a Roman legionary base, what exactly are we looking for? What does one look like? Well, this is both an easy and a hard answer because, as it happens, the type of base that we're looking for, 2nd and 3rd century, probably housing an entire legion, is only known archaeologically from the Western Empire. And there they're well known. I have an image of some coming up. The only things that we have in the Levant are later, smaller fortresses. After the reign of Diocletian, he chopped up all the legions in the east and put them in much smaller fortresses in a big line north to south in Arabia and further to the east. We also have some things from the first century, in particular this famous camp here, which is from Masada. These are temporary camps, though they were occupied during the entirety of the siege of Masada. Fortunately for us, we know that the Romans used to build temporary legionary camps and permanent bases along the same architectural schematics. So we see something already that is rectangular in shape, more or less, has areas in corners for barracks and the major, the main camp, the main tent at the center as a headquarters. But we can also look for inspiration from the big legionary bases from the west. These things are really big. These are cities in themselves. This example from Novaesium is half a kilometer in this direction by 350 meters in this direction. These camps were very rarely isolated. Outside of the boundaries here, you had organic cities which grew up around them to support soldiers, probably a lot of prostitutes primarily, I imagine. But all of these, the infrastructure that you would need to house 5,000 soldiers and everything that they need on a daily life. And many of these actually grew up to become the famous cities of Europe today. Vindobanda is in Austria and is actually under the modern city of Vienna. And so while we know a lot about many of these Western bases through archaeology over the last 150 years, many of them are difficult to access because they are in fact part of modern cities. Carnuntum, also in Austria, about an hour east of Vienna, is fairly well known. It's in an open field, very much like Legio, as we will see. So we know a lot about it. And you can see here a template for what these bases more or less looked like. And this template is important because it is what we kind of had in our hand during the excavation to try to figure out what we're dealing with. Great, so here you see a template, more or less how these things work. They're large rectangles. They have a fortification wall which goes all the way around it, which in this case is just the smaller line. The larger blue line represents essentially a moat, a fosse, which surrounded the whole camp. These could be quite deep. There could be numerous. They sometimes will have as many as three of them outside of here. There are two main roads through the camp, a one that goes in this direction down the center, which of course has gates on either side, and the second main road, the Via Principia, which usually runs about a third of the way through one side and has major gates here. Some of them will also have subsidiary roads here, but as you can see, there are plenty of other roads in between all sorts of other buildings. The main buildings which you'll find inside are of this shape, and these are the barracks for the soldiers. As I said, about 5,000 soldiers could be expected to be in any of these bases in the second and third century. There are other things as well, including baths and hospitals, but we'll skip over those for the moment. And just mention for just a second here the two central buildings, the Principia, which is more or less the headquarters building where the treasury is kept, where major meetings are held and other activities like that, including religious ceremonies, which we may come to in a moment. The other is the Praetorium, which is essentially a villa for the camp commander. And as you can see, it's similar in size. This is a very important individual. We'll come back to that as well. So let's talk about the excavations now. We've had two seasons of excavation, 2013, which is a very short trial season, and then 2015, which is 4 weeks. We'll be back in the field this summer, so if you like what you see, I would be very happy if you came and visited. It's really a lot of fun. The first things that we did is try to take a look at the topography of this hill, Manach, which we had already sort of hypothesized was going to be the location of the base. And if you have a good eye, you might see what we started to see almost immediately is that there are shadows and shapes that are rectilinear just from aerial photography. In particular, you see something here and another one that is parallel here. In different images taken at different times, you can also see something here and sometimes some things on this side. To get a more detailed understanding of this topography, we commissioned a LIDAR study, which is essentially sending an airplane with a really awesome laser to zap the ground and give us very detailed micro topographical data, which helped us form this image here, and then later this image, which really was highlighted some of the topography. And as you can see, the lines that I was referring to are here. And topographically speaking, these two things are depressions in the ground, and they're long and they are linear. So we began to develop a model for what we were seeing here and how it might connect to the template that we've been discussing. And really, there was just enough evidence to suggest that, yeah, there's probably a base here. These depressions probably represent the fosse, and that's great, that's what we expect. But there was some difficulty in determining how big it was in this direction. Does it end here, or does it continue to the other side of the main road and become a more rectangular shape? This is important, again, because we don't know what these bases in the Eastern Empire looked like. We're kind of in new territory here and had to be careful about what we were doing. And in particular, this larger rectangular here, we did a ground-penetrating radar study, and the results were more or less ambiguous, but they did seem to suggest that right about here, there was something going in this direction. But it wasn't clear if this was a negative, another depression under the ground, or perhaps something built as well. So in our preliminary model, we thought that, okay, this could either be the foss of a smaller camp, or possibly a street as part of a larger camp. And so excavations began. Here you see Tel Megiddo in the north. Nazareth is just on this hill over here. That's me. It's my wife. She says I always show pictures of me in my lectures, and I see she's right. Some of them are much more than others. I'll introduce you here. This is Yotam. You can't tell now, but he's really giddy right now. This is after years of studying and working on this issue, finally got to break ground on the first day. And here are the results of our first two-week trial. We wanted to get a good sense of what we were dealing with. We had this ground-penetrating radar. We had this LIDAR topography and other fancy things like that. So what we decided to do is just to run a simple line of squares as far as we can go in 2 weeks and see what we had. And we set it up in such a way, we're now looking to the south. This is the prison down here. This is the modern city of Umm al-Fahim, who Schumacher tells us were the guys that were stealing all the blocks over a century ago. And you see that we started on the north side in one of the long depressions and moved up the slope as far as we could. We got about 100 meters, which is really a long way to excavate over 2 weeks. But the reason we were able to do that is because this was a very easy excavation. We can excavate in one square and be done in a day or two and move on and just keep on moving up the line. Now, this is both a good thing and a bad thing that it was so easy. Here we are on day one, and our volunteers immediately came down upon architecture. That's because this is a modern field, and it's continuously plowed on a regular basis. It was robbed out, as I said, over a century ago. And so we're really seeing just very minimal foundations of buildings here. So in that sense, it's easy because everyone else has taken away everything. So it's not necessarily a happy thing. But we did have some really good success. Once again, we are now turned the other way. This is the north side down in the depression and headed up the hill over here. And as you can see, there are things inside. So let's take a look at those. We'll start in the depression and move this direction and talk a little bit about what we found and how it informs our reconstruction of the Roman military base. So once again, I'm now turning sideways. This is the depression, and this is uphill to the south. And that same image is up here for you. So we'll start here, and we'll just go up the line. This is one of the first things uncovered. It was seemingly disappointing at first. It's in the very center of the depression. And we went down through a lot of dirt until we got, you know, first I should say that the entire region here is limestone with some basalt outcroppings underneath. And what we realized is that this larger depression was a human cut area that had cut through all of the limestone down into the underlying basalt. And at the very center bottom of the basalt was a man-made V-shaped channel. Moving upslope, and we'll interpret all these things together in just a moment, right at the crest of the ridge, we found this jumble of stones here, which I will help you with. This is the two sides of a very poorly preserved, almost 8 meter wide wall, which runs parallel to our depression here. And we understand this to be the main fortification wall of the camp. And here you see a few examples. These aren't really good examples because they come from the west. And in the west, the primary building material was wood and earth. Here, they are using much more local stone, but this gives you a good idea. Typically, you have a large fortification wall with the moat, usually one or two of these V-shaped channels, often downslope as well. This is a reconstruction from Hadrian's Wall, which is built along the same idea of the fortification wall and a slope down into the moat. Here you see our wall and our V-shaped channel in profile. The wall, slope down to the V-shaped channel, and so on. There might be another V-shaped channel down here as well. But it does fit very nicely the expectations for a Roman legionary base's fortifications, which is great. Just inside of the wall, just to the south of it, we have an in-situ line of water pipes, which are filled with mud, but that's okay. Very much like the ones that have been found in surveys in the area. And these are datable in a broad sense, and they're certainly part of the Middle Roman period, and are the water supply pipes for the camp. And as you'll see, we found these in quite a number of places. Moving upslope, we have, in sum, a series of smaller rooms, the overall plan of which is not exactly clear, but it doesn't matter because they are smaller rooms and consistent with the general shapes and sizes that we expect from barracks of Roman legionary bases. So I'll just kind of go quickly through these in the interest of time. Every group of these smaller rooms was separated by alleyways which were cut into the bedrock. Some of them had sewage channels cut into them as well, like this one as well. The Romans were pretty good with water and sewer, that sort of thing. This room, which is just as I've been describing, smaller chambers separated by alleyways from other ones, gave us some of our densest amount of archaeological finds, and I'll show you some of those now. First of all, at the very center of one of these rooms was this very curious, almost closet-like space in a larger room. You see, it's not very big. It's only about a meter and a half by meter and a half. But at the center was this curious stone with a hole inside of it. And we don't exactly know what this was for, but considering that these might be the barracks for Roman soldiers, this might be an emplacement for some of the various types of standards that the Roman military would carry around, including our friends here. Most of the rooms in this particular place, as they were everywhere, but this place particularly dense because the preservation was better, were filled with Roman roof tiles. And these are great because Roman roof tiles are distinctive, so we had no trouble saying that they were Roman. You see how they've collapsed inside of the buildings here. These are the general shapes that we find them in, these kind of broad U shapes with the, it looks like you're in Tucson, doesn't it? The Romans came up with this. And then these curved things which covered the joins of the tiles. At the end of the roofs, you would often have decorative elements. We had one of them here, this Medusa figure, which is nice, one of our nicer finds. Many of these roof tiles had stamps with the Roman 6th Legion mentioned on them. When we finally found, this is one of the first ones we identified, which is kind of annoying, because what we really want at the end of the day from an archaeological and historical point of view is a stamp with a clear inscription of who was here, Roman 6th Legion. This is what we were hoping for, this is what we wanted. The first one only said leg Roman numeral V, so it could be the Roman 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th Legion. Finally, within a few days, we found another roof tile with the remainder of the inscription on it, which gives us the Roman numeral 6 and then F-E-R-R for the nickname of the legion, the Ferrata Legion, the Iron Legion. So that was very nice. We also, I mean, we're looking for a military base. It was nice also to find these bronze scales from armor, lamps from the second century, ton of coins, 300 or 400 coins we have so far, all which concentrate in the second and third centuries, which are the dates we understand historically. These were very interesting. These are we had a cache of three of these hemispherical lead ingots, which as far as we know so far are unique. Most metal ingots in use in the Roman period were long, kind of like gold bars that we think of today, but much longer and with inscriptions on them. So we don't know exactly what these are for. Our preliminary chemical study of these suggests that possibly the lead has come from Spain, though we're still working with several people on it. This is one of the nice finds. This is a panther or other feline figure on a broken table leg. Examples like this, especially with three legs, are known from Pompeii and other places. In fact, we have one of these also from Caparcotani that was found during the salvage excavations as well. A different lion, so different table, but nice nonetheless. Also in one of the buildings, somebody had later, probably at the end of the occupation of the camp, dug a pit and a cave and covered that cave with a large round stone. And it took a while to get that stone out. But what we found behind it was the cave filled with other stones as well, and eventually in the back this beautiful hollowed out hemispherical cave with a single Roman cooking pot in the back with a nice lid on top of it, inside of which was this poor fellow, a cremation burial, certainly Roman in style. We found a lot of these. These are stone vessels of a very well-known type. These are known as kalal. They are Jewish ritual vessels. What are they doing in a Roman legionary base? I suppose you could easily answer that by saying, well, there's a Jewish village nearby, and the Roman soldiers could have whatever they wanted, so probably occasionally they wanted a nice stone vessel. And that may be true, but the idea that the borders between the military camp and the civilian village, let alone the Jewish part of that village, that they're permeable, and we find artifacts that belong to each kind of smeared across this landscape, suggests a very complex relationship that is one of our ongoing research interests now and in the future. At the southern portion, we found a much larger road, which also is flanked by two sewage channels. That's great, and more rooms continuing with roof tiles and that sort of thing. So in general, we found what we were pretty confident at the end of the 2013 season saying is the Roman military base of the 6th Legion, and it was occupied from the 2nd and 3rd century, and that seemed to answer a big chunk of our research questions right up front, which always feels good. The outstanding question was kind of the layout of the camp. How does it fit into Roman military architecture around the Mediterranean? And so we set out in the following year to figure that out. And one of the questions, of course, is the GPR data and this strange line that we see in this area, does it represent a road or the end of the camp? And if it's the end of the camp, why is it smaller than in the west? And what does that say about the deployment of legions there? So we thought we could have something like this or something broader as well. 2015 team. This year we worked for one full month, which is great, so twice as long, a bigger team. We worked in two areas, areas B and C, which were designed to focus more or less in the central area of the camp. Especially C was meant to cross that area that could either be the end of the small version of the camp or the a major road of the larger version of the camp. These images that follow are really awesome for archaeologists. I hope you'll understand them. I think you will, but maybe you won't think they're as neat. These are orthophotos. That is, they are photos that represent exactly what's on the ground without the distortion of photography that have been referenced according to the geospatial grid and put where they belong. So these are pictures taken throughout the season and recompiled into a single aerial-looking image. And I will say, but this can be another lecture, that my team is one of the teams that is pioneering this technique in Israel, and it's becoming very popular throughout the world archaeologically. And what we see here answered some of our questions almost in the first week of excavation. And what looks like a bunch of rocks and dirt is, in fact, a major road system. Here you see on the east side a major wall. So what you probably gathered from some of those topographic images is this camp is built on a slope. And so terracing of roads and buildings was an essential part of construction in the area. And this road on the low side had a terrace wall. And on the inside of it was an 8 meter wide street, which is a big street, probably one of the main streets of the camp. Down the center was a sewage channel. All of this would have been capped with stone and had beautiful coverings for the sewage channel, which also would have been nicely decorated with stone. But as I said, most of the stone at the site has been robbed out, and we're forced to understand all of this architecture from remnants left behind, primarily foundations. But this is what a major Roman road would have looked like. These are external roads, meaning extramural roads outside of cities, but they would have been quite similar. I imagine this one would have looked a lot like the one we have here. Now, in addition to this road, we had a series of rooms over here that were very nicely built. And on the other side, very tantalizing fragments of monumental architecture. The lion that I mentioned is in the Rockefeller was found somewhere in this particular area. The monumental architecture is represented by a couple of these large walls here. I know they don't look like much, but they're much larger. You can see that the stones here are ashlar style, meaning they're large and rectangular. They're really huge. This one has a foundation that goes about a meter deep. It's part of some large building. We just have few pieces left behind. Not easy to detect. Also here are two large circular column bases. So we're looking at a major street, next to it some sort of large monumental public building that had a beautiful facade facing the main street. And if we go back to our template and put it in the large scale, you can get a sense of maybe what we're dealing with here. And I'm hoping excavations this summer will answer this more definitively. That is the main road, the Via Principia, that runs in this direction through the short side of the camp. Where it intersects near the center of the camp with the Principia, the main headquarters building. The Principia, here you see from Novaesium what one of these looked like. It doesn't look great, but it's essentially a monumental courtyard building with an open courtyard in the center, and at the back, a basilica-style structure. That is a structure with three long halls, and in the rear halls, you would have things like the treasury. You would keep some of the main standards and archives of the legion, the standard, the poles. The commander would hold audience here and so forth. So this is really an essential part of the camp, not just because we all like to dig big, giant buildings, but this is where all of the administrative activity would have taken place and promises to give us some of the answers to those types of questions. The other area that we were working at was just to the west in this direction, where my circle is, and you can already guess that we were hoping that if this is the Principia, we might come across remains of the Praetorium, the commander's residence. And while I can't say definitively we do have the commander's residence, I can say that we have something that's pretty close. First of all, Area B is a little bit smaller, but it has some of the same basic features. You're looking at another road here, which is supported by a terrace wall on this side, so it's higher over here and lower over here. Down the center, just the few remnants of the central sewage channel on the other side over here. Like in road construction today, underneath the roads, the Romans put all of their water supply pipes in addition to their sewers. And what you see in this square are some of these pipes. The pipe infrastructure was quite extensive. Romans liked their water. Another image here for you. But you can see some of the things that we were dealing with. So much of this site has been plowed over and robbed out that all we're getting are the substructures of some of these big architectural units. And we have to reconstruct, rightfully, that over top of this would have been several layers of constructional fill and on top of which a nice pavement for the road. And here you're looking at part of the terrace wall, which shows how nice it was. These ones, unlike the other ones that we saw earlier, are beautifully cut and kind of battered up onto the road itself. To the south of the road is the last structure that we'll talk about today, which is a very nice structure. You can see that it also has some monumental stones in it. Here we go, some very large stones, including doorways coming in from the road into them. Most of the floor levels have been destroyed. We don't know a lot about this building. We do know something about the building just next to it, which may or may not be part of a larger complex here. And in particular, I want to point out this structure here, which was a very fun discovery. And it turns out to be a toilet, a very nice one, in fact. Here you're looking at kind of an oblique angle. It was paved with beautiful tiles, some of which had stamps on them. The stamps had been walked on so much that they were worn out, so we couldn't read them, but they were nice nonetheless. Part of the building carved out of the local bedrock, other parts built of stone. The toilet itself was kind of ringed with large ashlar stones, which created kind of access down. If you go down into there, you go down about a meter and a half into the main sewer line, leading out to the main sewer line of the street that we were referring to. What's missing here are the toilet seats, which would have sat just across the top of this and looked something like this. In fact, based on the size of it, we are pretty sure that we're dealing with a two-seater here. And of course, toilets and bathing and that sort of thing in the Roman world is very different than it is today. So one convenience that this building had, or this toilet had, that I haven't seen in other Roman toilets is this pipe here, which is just a pipe that would have allowed for a bucket of water to be dumped down it to kind of clean out the sewer underneath periodically. So a flushable toilet in the Roman period. Most of these other larger public baths would have had running water through there at all times anyway. Inside the sewer, we had some of our best assemblage of artifacts. The Romans, I guess, threw everything into the sewer. We had tons of glass fragments, pottery fragments, coins, animal bones. I mean, everybody's lunch ended up in the sewer directly under this toilet. Well, I won't talk about that today. It is possible, our hypothesis at present is that that's not just any toilet. That's the camp commander's toilet. The only other toilets we might expect in a legionary base would be part of the larger bathhouses, in which case they would be, you know, much more like this here. So it's nice to be able to brag about that. And we'll see this summer if that does, in fact, pan out to be part of the Praetorium. We did some preliminary ground-penetrating radar work in the area between these areas, and you can see that there's something here. This is the continuation of the street as we found it. And here we start to get over into that building which had the latrine in it, and you can see that there's other things going on here. We're going to be doing a much more detailed survey of the whole camp, or as much as we can, and excavation as well. So it's very exciting. We can now, that we know where the main road is, project it out, because we also know where the fortification line is, and we can estimate pretty accurately where we might expect to find one of the main gates of the camp. And the gates are not just gates. They're very impressive parts of these camps. You can see some examples here from Europe, two towers and an entranceway. If there are monumental building inscriptions that mention the emperor who commissioned the construction here, the name of the legion, and the date that they began construction, this is the most likely place to find it. So we'll probably also be working in this area as well. So that brings us back to the end and to Armageddon. And hopefully, I think, I've given you enough information, possibly, to think about the context here. Why does an apocalyptic writer in the, I would say, the early second century place the final battle, or rather the penultimate battle, because in the context of the military history in the book of Revelation, this gathering at Armageddon and the battle here takes place right before a battle in Jerusalem, which is going to end everything and bring about all of these wonderful times. So why Megiddo? Why this particular area? I think the answer is fairly straightforward and an historical one, and in fact maybe even a strategic one as well. As you, many of you probably know, what underlies a lot of the theology in Revelation is an historical narrative that is really aspiring. It's a group of people responding and rebelling against the Roman Empire and aspiring to oust the Romans completely. And in some cases, there are some very strategic military components of this. And of course, one, if the final battle is in Jerusalem, it's not just to recover Jerusalem, it's to kick out that 10th legion that is in Jerusalem. That's kind of the thing that signals victory. But before you get the 10th legion out of the way, you better get the 6th legion out of the way, or you will not be able to have success. And so I imagine that this writer is imagining a scenario in which the first step, guys, is to get everybody at Legio, that 6th legion, destroy them, and then we'll head up to Jerusalem, and we'll be free from the Romans. Great. Thank you.